Welcome out this morning to the Potter's House Church in Dandenong for our Bible Hour live stream. We're starting a little bit early this morning, so if you're tuned in early, yeah, you're on the money. We're going to be watching Pastor Mark Alson from the Prescott Conference in July, and so he goes for just under an hour, so we're going to get cracking on that now so we can be ready to go for main service in about 57 minutes. So let's open our hearts. Let's let God speak to us. We're going to get that rolling right now.
Amen. What a blessing it is to stand behind the sacred desk, Prescott Conference. Always a great privilege and honor to preach to you this worldwide fellowship of ours. And may the Lord help us. May the Lord visit you. Already this morning, we've had such outstanding ministry. Praise God. I want to begin my sermon by recounting a statement made by one of our founding fathers in America, Ben Franklin. And he was coming out of the Independence Hall after a conference with other founding fathers where they're trying to hammer out the Constitution. And so as he stepped out from locked doors and shut windows, he was asked by an anxious lady, one Elizabeth Powell, "Well, doctor, what have we got? A republic or a monarchy?" "A republic," replied the doctor. And then he quipped, "If you can keep it." So this prescient remark that was made over 230 years ago, I believe is still being determined as we speak this morning. And in fact, if we are realistic and honest, the jury is still out as to the final outcome of the matter for our country. But for our purposes this morning, what was said in the forging of a new government, I'd like to apply to all of us here this morning in our conference-wide fellowship as we think about prophetic fulfillment and a crucial time of transition. And I'm going to preach out of Jude, one verse of scripture, and I'm ministering a message I've entitled, "A Fellowship, If We Can Keep It." Jude verse 3, "Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints." So I want to begin by taking a brief sketch of our history, and I'm going to put on, as it were, my history hat, and I want to skim pertinent, salient features of our fellowship, of what makes our fellowship unique, and a God-inspired movement. And given the fact that I'm the one that's going to do the sketching, I want to give and present my own credentials. I was saved here in Prescott in 1974 under Pastor Mitchell. I came on staff in January of 1978, and I was the door director on staff for 1 year. Then I was sent out to pioneer a church in Cortez, Colorado. I was the 18th pastor sent out, pioneer sent out of Prescott. And at that time, there were 33 churches, if my memory serves me right, overall. I spent 2 years in Cortez, Colorado. Then I took over an established church in Sierra Vista, which I pastored for 5 years. At the end of that, I was launched into the Philippines from 1986 to 1995, and then I came back to Prescott for 1 year as a staff evangelist in my mother church, reconnected with Pastor Mitchell in the Prescott Church. Then I was launched into Houston to pioneer, and I spent about a year and a half in that city. And then I received an invitation from Pastor Mitchell to come back and be his assistant on staff here in Prescott for 14 months. Then there was a need that arose. There was a church that was in great turmoil in Tempe, Arizona. And I offered myself, my wife and I, responded to that need, and we went down and became the pastors. We were the eighth pastors of that congregation, and of which those eight pastors, Kevin Foley is still with us, and we thank God for Brother and Sister Foley and their faithfulness. I've had the privilege of being on the Board of Elders for 20 years, and I state my resume because, again, I want to establish my credentials. Obviously, this is just one man's opinion. I have some older brothers, Pastor Harold Warner, Pastor Tom Drought, and I'm sure that they can supply many other points and many they can fill in many of the gaps that I'm going to leave out. And so you could check with them for their version of the story, a version of the events. As most of you would know, but for those that don't, Pastor Mitchell and his wife and family, five kids, came to Prescott in 1970. And this was in response to this church that was a denominational church with the Four Square Movement. And it had gone through a horrible time. Both the pastor and the pastor's adult son had fallen into immorality. Pastor Mitchell was not exactly keen on coming here, but as I understand it, he put a fleece before the Lord. He understood that there was two young couples. The church had been scattered. The church was very, very demoralized and shattered, as you can well imagine. And Pastor Mitchell had heard there was two young couples, the Copelands and the Allens. And so he drove up and met these two couples, talked to them, and put a fleece before the Lord. Said, God, if these two couples will stay and not leave the church, I'll take that as a sign from you that you would have me to come here. And so both couples agreed, and Pastor Mitchell moved here and began the fellowship in 1970. And again, we've heard that message, Pastor Ruby, so eloquently last night. What was evil and what was a very bad situation, God turned it around, and God worked for good to bring our pastor right here to Prescott, Arizona. Pastor Mitchell began to preach the gospel, and this coincided with the Jesus People movement. This resulted in numbers of young people and hippies being swept into the kingdom and into the church here in Prescott. Pastor Mitchell has many, many times stated he did not have an exact blueprint to go off of them. It wasn't a preset plan or some kind of a vision that he had a watertight vision in his mind, but rather he responded to what God was doing. And I can say, having been in the early stages, the spirit of my pastor was characterized by at a redemptive spirit towards hippies. And again, just to try to paint the picture, the church that he came into had a lot of older people, denominational people, very set in their ways, very religious people, and many of them of the gray set in terms of age. And so they weren't necessarily thrilled by the prospects of the type of people that God was bringing. But Pastor Mitchell convinced them that these strange critters underneath their bird nest hair, underneath their bizarre tie-dyed clothes and bouncing, braless, bouncing Betties, that, you know what, that God can move and God can touch these people. And underneath it all, souls were there worth saving and investing in. He sought to tie on to what God was unfolding. And in the process of time, in the early stages, I believe it was around 1972, he took a couple of guys. They went over to California to check out what was happening there. Chuck Smith and Calvary Chapel and the Jesus coffee houses were beginning to emerge. And so he went over there to check out that scene and see what was going on. While he was there at one of the coffee houses and he's analyzing this, he happened to encounter on the beach scene an unforgettable character by the name of Larry Reed. And he was able to invite this itinerant street preacher to come to Prescott and shake things up in this little sleepy town of Prescott. In the process of time, as he was inspired by what he saw in California, he started the music scene, and they called it The Door. That's where the name that a number of our churches, including Tucson, Tempe, Chandler, were called The Door. That's where that name came from. Originally, it was an auxiliary outreach of the church, the music scene. Because we didn't know any better at the time, Pastor Mitchell was just trying to work with people that God had brought him. He begins to see the signs of the call of God on some young promising men. So he sent two of them over to our Four Square denominational Bible school. While they were over there, both of them got ripped off in immorality. And this caused a seminal pivot point in our movement. He said, I'm not going to do that anymore if those guys are going to just get ripped off. Instead, I'm going to keep them here, and I'm going to disciple them locally. Now, this meant giving them expression. They got to preach in the music scene. They got to preach on the street corner. There were concerts held at various venues, and they were given expression. There was doors that opened in the jail, at various the colleges and different places. And Pastor Mitchell, having come into possession of a book by Robert Coleman called The Master Plan of Evangelism. In that book, you can sum it up with three words: instruction, impartation, and involvement. And so Pastor Mitchell began to express a willingness to work with whoever God brought in. He was willing to take a risk on people that society discounted or wouldn't look twice at. It actually kind of reminds me of David's ragtag group that he assembled. The Bible tells us that they fell out of the coast of Israel under the time of Saul, and they began to associate with David those that were in debt, distressed, and discontented. And I must say, that describes most of us at that time perfectly. But what stands out and what stood out was that it was marked by the spirit of that period of time in our church and in our very fledgling fellowship was a spirit of redemption. The goal, very, very clearly, I believe every one of us that came into the Prescott church, and we passed through the turnstiles, and we got saved, and very quickly, every one of us believed that we had a call from God to be a witness, to be a testimony, and to be a disciple. Very quickly, we learned that Jesus' great commission was not to go into all the world and make believers, but to go into all the world, as it's more correctly translated, and make disciples of all nations. So, as the process of time goes by, a number of these young men having experience, having more and more fruit in their personal lives, we, so to speak, stumbled into church planting. Many of you perhaps don't know, but the organization we're a part of in the hinterland or the internal part of the United States, many of the buildings, four square buildings, were empty buildings. They had a bit of a move on the coast, and I think it was the attitude of a lot of the people in that denomination that California was the place to be. And Arizona was the place, or Colorado or New Mexico, these were places to be avoided at all costs. And because this was a movement under Amy Semple McPherson back in the 30s and the 40s, there were numbers of churches that had been planted, but now they're sitting empty. And so almost as a turn of fate, you could say, Pastor Mitchell, having worked with some of these young guys, said, hey, there's a building in this little town, this little cow town, Wickenburg, population 3,000. It's sitting there open. How about if one of our guys goes down and preaches? There was a supervisor that was willing to allow that. And so the experiment began. And so Flagstaff and Tucson and Yuma and Nogales, and we launched some of these young couples into these rickety old church buildings that other people didn't want. And during that time, a great revelation was birthed in Pastor Mitchell, and that was the principle of the indigenous church principle. God has given the dignity to the local church that the local church has in seed form everything that it's required, that is required to fulfill the Great Commission. So let me just kind of trace this out, map this out with you. If a church is evangelizing, as opposed to, say, just running old routines and rituals and programs, but if they actually pressing out of the four walls and evangelizing, the gospel produces fruit, and there will be converts. And if you get converts, then they're going to be open to become disciples if you will contend for an atmosphere that you will press them and you will urge them towards some kind of expression of ministry that involves evangelism. So it began that because Jesus worked with his disciples for 3 years, Pastor Mitchell said that that's what we need to do with our disciples. And so there was a three-year, an understanding that we were going to go through 3 years of discipleship, and then we would become open or have the opportunity to be launched out. Now, that triggered a dynamic I want to talk to you and emphasize a little bit, because in it, the home folks, now these are sons and daughters out of that congregation. These are not people from a denomination. These are not poster childs of those that there's no relationship or any kind of bond to. These are sons and daughters born in the house that the church congregation had relationship with that they loved. This removes the impersonal spirit that typically describes denominational programs. And now it made it intensely personal. The church had a vested interest in these couples that were being launched out, and Pastor Mitchell was able to see that very, very clearly. These couples would then be launched out to the various cities around, and they were given the marching orders, you are to go and you are to reproduce the vision, the pattern of your mother church. And so that was the goal. It wasn't anything that was complex. We could see very clearly what Pastor Mitchell emphasized. And so then we would pattern our brand new church, our pioneer church, off of back home. And God was pleased to bless us. God was pleased to help us. And as a consequence, we became self-supporting, self-governing, and self-propagating as the movement began to take on mass and began to accelerate. Now, what is striking is Pastor Harold Warner was launched into Kearney, Arizona. I believe that was in 1973. And for the record, I believe Pastor Warner holds the shortest length of time for pioneering, one weekend. And that's not because there was any problem in his abilities or he was full of fire and passion. In fact, when he went to Kearney, they had asked for one of our young men. When he went there with another pastor, young pastor, they went there their very first weekend. They had a PA, and they marched in a street parade, and they preached the gospel, and established a religious church. That wasn't what they had in mind when they thought about getting a new pastor, and so they summarily dismissed him and sent him back home. Tragically, on the way back, the car slipped off the pavement and had a bit of a roll. Pastor Warner broke his back. Now, Pastor Mitchell's response to that is very, very interesting, very inspirational. Now, let's just go back. So you have young couples that we're sending out, and one of these very precious couples, Pastor Harold Warner and his wife Mona, very young, I think in their early 20s, and now Brother Warner is in a hospital with his back broken. No doubt that produced quite a stir back home in the Prescott Church, that caused tongues to begin to wag, that caused people and religious people to begin to manifest and said, aha, aha, this is none other than the judgment of God, and this is God judging, you know what, we're not to send out workers. We shouldn't think that we're, able to bypass the Bible school. Who does Pastor Mitchell think he is? And so there was those, the naysayers, that begin to wag their tongues. My wife, Michelle, she got saved in Prescott in 1972. She was in the service right after Pastor Warner had his terrible accident. What she recalls is that Pastor Mitchell stood up and preached, and he preached a message of challenge, a message of inspiration, whereby he challenged the church to a time of fasting. I'm not sure if it was 3 or 5 or 7 days fast, but he made a statement that struck my wife and has been one of the most powerful statements in our fellowship history. And that statement was, if the devil kills one of us, we're going to send out 10 more to take their place. Brother, sister, that's called in-your-face, radical, aggressive evangelism, confidence, and courage in the face of demonic crossfire and hellfire. Amen. So out of that, it's very, very noteworthy that we cut our teeth on the reality of Matthew 11, verse 12. The kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. It's an understatement to say that our fellowship has been opposed by Satan. I'm going to take up some of the counter assaults in a bit, but suffice to say, we did not get a free pass. This work of God that we are a part of was forged by blood, sweat, commitment, sacrifice, desperate faith, and a good measure of tears to boot. And it reminds me of Apostle Paul when he recounts some of his battles. And in the book of Galatians, he is jousting with some of the religious critics that are carping at him, and he has this rebuttal in Galatians 6, verse 17. From henceforth, let no man trouble me, for I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus. So we're not talking about theory. We're not talking about nice sounding principles of this or that. We're talking about bare knuckle in the arena, fighting it out, blood and sweat and tears. And when the devil punched us in the mouth a few times, we had to spit some teeth out, but yet we got back up. And even if he knocked out a few teeth, we tried to gum him to death. the hinge pin. We were forging this movement out on the anvil of life and ministry, and there was a spirit that God injected into our fellowship. Yes, a spirit of revival that detonated a movement that carried our fellowship forward and upward. And I believe it is a distinctive of our fellowship that we have a spirit from God. And I'm not just a general, I'm talking about a distinctive spirit of our fellowship. I believe this is unique in the world at large. I don't say that makes us better. I say that does make us distinct, and we have entered into a fellowship birthright. This is why we don't do joiners well. This is why you either have to be born into the house like Abraham's servants, Genesis 14, 14. And when Abraham heard that Lot was taken captive, he armed his trained servants, born in his own house, 318, and pursued them unto Dan. We are a fellowship that believes in evangelizing and having your own new converts. We don't pioneer churches by trying to proselyte others, disaffected members from other churches, or try to wave some kind of a ministry or some kind of an incentive to get people to jump ship from their existing church and come help us and join ours. We believe pioneering. We birth our own converts. We build upon new converts in our churches. Yes, amen. There are those that God has joined by, I would call it, sovereign choice and sovereign decision of God. I'm very thankful for that. We have such illustrious members as Pastor Joe Campbell, Pastor Glenn Cluck. But here's a little point that I would say. Those that join us, in the Old Testament, they had a principle. And that principle is called circumcision. And I'm not going to be insensitive, but it's a cutting of the flesh. And those that would join us, they don't just come and just get a little membership card and become one of us. They come in and they put themselves in submission to headship, and they have to allow a pastor. Many times it was Pastor Mitchell. They have to allow that pastor to speak into their life, to correct, to discipline, in effect, to cut their flesh. And those are the ones that become pillars in part of our movement, either new converts or those that have submitted to circumcision in the spiritual sense. I got saved in 1974, and around, I checked this morning actually, was with Pastor Mitchell, it was October. Pastor Mitchell had the first Bible conference. It was a deliverance and healing conference at the suggestion of Pastor Johnny Metzler. Pastor Mitchell's close friend, and I remember the announcements for the conference. I'm relatively a brand new convert. I knew it was for pastors and their wives. We had Wes Baker and Al Fury were the two main speakers, and my heart was so excited, and I thought, you know what, I got to get into that. And I didn't think I was going to be allowed. So what's the old thing? Don't ask permission, just say you're sorry if you get caught. So I snuck in, and I honestly waited. I was waiting for Bob Allen to tap me and say, what are you doing here? You're just a little foot soldier, get out of here. But I was allowed to stay, and I had a wonderful time, and there were less people at that conference in October 1974 in the morning services than are in the building right now. There was about 35 people, and there was six couples was the sum total. At nighttime, I think we ran about 350 or 400 in the evening services. The rest of the church joined, and I was an eyewitness to the beginnings of that. There was a spirit that was imparted, and that spirit, I'm happy to say, is still amongst us. It needs stirring, it needs kindling, but that spirit was, we can take the land, we will take the world. You say, that's absolutely ridiculous. You're 35 people in a morning conference, and you guys are marching around on the platform and prophesying. And I remember the first prophecy I ever heard was from Rodney Mathis. I believe he's still in the Prescott Church all these years later. And that prophecy was, I have set you, Prescott, as a city upon a hill. Let your light shine unto all the world. I will make this place a testimony unto the east, the west, the north, and the south. And I'll never forget the feeling of elation within me. My spirit leapt. I said, this is it. Glory to God. Though I missed Woodstock because I was too young to make Woodstock. I thought I was cursed for life because I didn't make it. I was so thrilled that I was able to get here and in at the ground level, so to speak, and I connected with the big time. I was enrolled in Providence College. I took a leave of absence. I had a girlfriend for a number of years. I broke that relationship. I told my parents that are Catholics. I said, I'm going to live for God. Jesus has come into my life. And all the other things that I was willing to do. Why? Because God was so real and his will must be done. The times were characterized by radical commitments. I look now and I say, that was a radical commitment, but at the time, it seemed like nothing. It seemed like the only logical thing to do. Jesus is real. You put your hand to the plow. If the Son of God is willing to forgive a wicked man like me, and he's willing to work with me and help me and love me, there's nothing too great of a price that could be offered in exchange for that. And there was a prevalent spirit amongst our disciples. I got saved. I moved into a boy's house. There was constant. It was like a zoo, constantly coming in and out. At some times there was up to 15 single guys, and what a great way to learn Christianity. You'd have your macaroni and cheese, your hamburger helper, you'd have your little corner, and someone would steal your food, and instead of killing them, you learn to have to forgive. And so God was moving, and he caused evil to work good in our lives. And so this was a grand time, man. People were getting saved. People were coming, the wandering, people across the nation. And so no turning back, no regrets, no looking back. So God was helping Pastor Mitchell step by step, line upon line, here a little and there a little. We stumbled upon the conference. And so I want to talk to you for a moment about this. So it turned in after the first conference was so successful that Pastor Mitchell began to have that every 6 months. And so I just did the math. Now we're at 46 and a half years running, having conferences. No, COVID can't stop us, and we're still excited about conference, praise God. Now, if you go back and see how it unfolded and what was being accomplished, basically, conference was to meet needs. You'll find that most everything that was implemented in our fellowship was based on practical issues and responding to needs and simply seeking to help people to make it serving God, make it in their ministry, having opportunities, opening doors, and so forth. But the conference is a critical part of our fellowship and of our story. Every 6 months, these pastors would come in. I remember Pastor Mitchell saying, they have to come back every 6 months because if they don't, they'll lose their minds. And what was taking place is that these guys could come home And though they may be few in number, pioneering, might be out in strange places, what a wonderful, wonderful respite to come home to Prescott, where people knew you and loved you and were praying for you and were pulling for you. And then you'd hear 17 sermons from quality preachers and quality ministry, and so many things were able to be adjusted and recalibrated. And not only we were able to get back in the presence with our pastor, headship connections were reestablished and fixed. Not only that, but much ministry took place apart from the morning seminars. Coffees. I can remember when I first used to go to the conference, I used to do breakfast, lunch, coffee before the service and after service. And so there was all kinds of fellowship and cross-pollinating going on. And the genius of having conference where you got reconnected. And so I want to make a plug. You know what? Conference saved our bacon. Not only the men, but the wives as well. And so just for what it's worth, it still accomplishes that, and that we have that opportunity to cross-pollinate. Praise God. So as the time went on, this created a larger and larger home base, and it enabled us to have a launching pad to challenge the group together. We didn't have all these churches yet. We didn't have all these subsidiary conferences. So here's Prescott, the mother of all conferences. And it gave us a launching pad to begin to aim towards world evangelism. This created an atmosphere where people gave beyond just the ordinary giving. This caused us to tap miracle resources. I know that you hear, appeals for the offering, but just, I'm not going to take an offering. Just relax for a moment. Well, maybe the Lord's dealing with me. Maybe I'm going to pull an offering. But no, just relax. I want you to really think about, as these conferences unfolded and we started gaining momentum and strength and a larger base, we were able to tap miracle resources, and there was a huge discovery that people were willing to give far, far more to sons and daughters that they know personally than a program of collecting old socks and used underwear to send to the missionary in need. We laugh, but I'm hoping that you're really getting what I'm saying. One of the hallmarks of Pastor Mitchell, my pastor, how can I serve your faith? How can I serve your ministry? What can I do for you? Now, this might be taken for granted or presumed on by the third, fourth, or whatever generation we're up to of church kids, but I assure you it was completely revolutionary and still is. That we don't have a cover charge to come to conference. We have never required anybody to put money up to help pay for the speakers, to have any kind of admission fee to pay for the donuts and the cleaning crew. We have simply put out an invitation to come. And the spirit behind it has been, you come and we're going to serve your faith. And we count it a great blessing that we're able to invest and we're able to impart and bring blessing to your ministry. Now, as that took place, I believe that God met the need by our regular offerings during conference. But again, you have no idea how extraordinary that is in the church world around us. And so again, I want to emphasize, we have made it our priority to invest in people over buildings, invest in couples ministry over programs. Our treasure is not, never has been, never will be our land holdings, our fancy buildings, our treasure is our workers. Now, the next facet, we outgrew the denomination that we were part of. And this is important, so please don't miss this. We were asked to leave, particularly not myself, but being attached to Pastor Mitchell. We were asked to leave. I remember being with Pastor Mitchell and discussing some of the things that were going on, because when we were a novelty, it was like a nice experiment, the Arizona Fellowship. We were like the bearded lady at the circus. We were a novelty. And besides, they had empty buildings. What did they have to lose? And you know what? Amazingly, our guys would send in reports and actually send in tithes. And so, hey, man, what's not to like about that? From a denominational point of view, they're getting actually resources. I remember John Holland, the area supervisor Southwest, saying, it's amazing because you guys in Southwest, in Arizona, an economically depressed economy based on copper, depressed, you guys are actually sending in more money in the arrangement we had. We were sending in more money than the much more prosperous California churches. So that's very, very interesting on the face of it. So we were pressured now because we began to outgrow just the few churches in Arizona. Now our number is growing, so there were those that were threatened. We didn't have the proper credentials, and we didn't have the proper effeminate voice when we preached, and the other reasons. And so we were unceremoniously asked to leave. I remember Pastor Mitchell discussing this with me, and he said, very, very blunt, Pastor Mitchell, what you see is what you get. He said, we're not rebels, Alson. We're not rebels. We're not making the moves rebels make. Rebels don't evangelize for new converts. Rebels evangelize to proselyte, but rebels don't evangelize for new converts. I mean, soul winning. And rebels don't plant churches. So these are not the moves of those in rebellion. And he discussed and had sermons about Martin Luther and John Wesley were forced out. So we maintained our commitment as we we had a parting of the ways, but we didn't miss a beat. In fact, we picked up the pace. And then another door began to open to us. And that was that we began to put our big toe into the great waters of world evangelism. So Holland had somebody come over then Australia. And what would happen was that we were invited into these various nations because they would hear the testimony of our young firebrands and the music bands. And so we would be invited different places like the Philippines and go in and have these healing crusades. So in the early days, we would go in for, say, a denomination guy or somebody that was based with some other fellowship. We would go in and we would bring resources. We would have evening crusades at the plaza, morning seminars. Often one of the brothers would preach the healing crusade. Pastor Mitchell, a couple others would do the morning seminars. But what we found happening in the Philippines and different other nations in Africa, India, was that the fruit would respond. We'd have a great response. But then after we left, the people would backslide. And so we just came to that decision, you know what? Rather than just go in and send teams, we're going to plant in those areas. And that's how we established base camps in the Philippines, for example. We gained our own converts, our own disciples, and planted churches. And it exploded literally into a worldwide movement that we're a part of today, 50 years down the track. That may not mean much to you, but 50 years down the tracks, continuing with the same burden and vision, 2,700 churches, over 120 countries, I believe. And so now, our father in the faith, has run his course, and thank God for him and all of his exampleship and inspiration and love. He birthed this movement. God used him to birth this movement. But in large measure, he's come to the last couple of laps of his course, and he's handed off the torch of leadership to a man that is not just simply his physical son, but a man of God in his own right, that clearly, anybody that's been paying attention, that clearly has been groomed by the Spirit of God for just such a time as this. Pastor Greg Mitchell, he has served, I believe it's 15 years, directly under his father's ministry. There has clearly been impartation far beyond physical DNA, but a spiritual DNA. He has been schooled in Christ Training University, and so now we have another chapter that is before us. And I want to say that our future is bright, very, very bright, if we keep in mind what the apostle exhorted us to contend for the faith once and for all delivered. And so that means that there's going to be a challenge, just like Ben Franklin, the haunting question as he answered Mrs. Powell that day. He said, we have given you a republic if you are able to keep it. So there's a challenge, and that is to keep and protect what God has given. And let me say, I'm not a dewy-eyed novice or neophyte. I feel like I'm a grizzled veteran of a number of different campaigns and conflicts, both home and abroad. And now I don't believe we're the only ones. I freely acknowledge that there's other flocks the Lord has. I freely acknowledge that there are people that are doing a good work for God. I praise God for everyone that preaches the gospel and helps us to finish the Great Commission. But having said that, I am very convinced that this is the only fellowship for me. I don't have other options. Just like God had all of us born in a family, and that was his choice. I believe the will of God truly has an address, and I believe that God connects us, according to 1 Corinthians 12:18, but God has set the members, every one of them, in the body as it pleased him. One of the oldest statements that I remember from Pastor Mitchell's lips is that we have membership forms on the back table that you can sign and join if you're wanting to do that, to vote in the annual meetings. But the real truth is that member joining is spiritual. If God joins you to us, then you are joined. If God does not join you to us, it doesn't matter if you sign 1,000 membership slips, you are not part of us. Now it stands to reason, or it should, whatever God raises up powerfully, whatever God is using, is going to be assaulted. And we've had our share. If you look at a complete history, we've had cycles. About every 10 years, there's been some things. We've had conflicts. We've had some splits. We've had some rebellions. Pastor Mitchell, when I was on staff, he was driving, and something was going on, and he turned to me and he said, "Alson, Jesus had a Judas, and so won't we." And I said, in my heart, "Is it I?" I found out later he was having some issues with somebody else. But you know what? That's actually a good prayer. "Search me, O Lord." And I don't like to dwell on that downside, but I like to have clear-eyed recognition. We're in unusual times. And just as Paul understood when there was a transitioning from Paul's ministry with the Ephesians, he saw fit to plainly warn them, Acts 20, 28. Take heed, therefore, unto yourselves and to all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers, to feed the church of God, which he hath purchased with his own blood. For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after them. Therefore watch and remember that by the space of 3 years I cease not to warn everyone night and day with tears. Now evidently, this was something that the apostle did not want the brethren to be ignorant of or to be blindsided when their world or their ministries were rocked and rolled. As I said, we've had a few splits back in 1990. There were some biggies, the big brothers, the golden boys at the time. They got a swelled head. They had a statement. Let me just tell you this. Redefinition covers a multitude of sins. Redefinition covers a multitude of agendas. So back in the 90s, there was guys that had this line, well, we're adult sons, and Pastor Mitchell needs to release us to our own destiny and our own calling to fulfill all the great things that we have in our life and in our mind. And they used him as a smokescreen issue, tithing back to the mother church. And we know this statement, the issue is never the issue. And so I'm just hitting that and passing by, I gotta move quick. And around 2000, there were some other restless leaders. The first split, the guys that were the ringleaders, they were more like my big brothers, my heroes. Around 2000, it was more like my peers and even some close friends, a man that had a hand in bringing me to Christ. And what was the issue? I'm sure the Lord alone knows exactly. In my opinion, they turned carnal. I want to give you a quote. The fellowship has not been tried and found wanting. It has been tried and found challenging. Therefore, carnal men and women go shuffling off to their own agendas. When you really lock in what we're called to do, discipline, leave the things of the world, no TVs, standards, we have fastings and we have commitments in our finances and so on and so forth. There's people who begin to get better ideas, and we have the joke in our fellowship. Ford may think they have a better idea, but remember, brother, you're not Ford. And let me also say this. Don't be a legend in your own mind. Now, let me conclude very, very quickly with the law of unintended consequences. The law of unintended consequences is that it never turns out the way people fantasize. There's two planets. There's planet fantasy. That's where you're able to craft the atmosphere, the music, the temperature, how everything is going to work out. It's all a beautiful, scheme of your own mind and your own crafting. And then there's another planet, and it's called reality, the way things actually do turn out. I want to tell you this. I've been involved now as a pastor for over 40 years. I'm drawing to a close. And I've had two churches that I was intimately involved with, Cortez, which we pioneered, and Sierra Vista, which we put our life in for 5 years. We handed those churches off in covenant to other men in good faith. We handed that off believing that we were in a covenant, that you're going to respect, that you're going to keep the same vision, that you're not going to exploit and try to fashion or seize upon that for your own ends or to use for your own agenda. And otherwise, we would never have given you that opportunity or that platform. We would never have done that. But the facts are, human nature is human nature. And in both of those churches, Cortez, mostly those people were lost to a rebel. And in Sierra Vista, the church was split in half. What's tragic was it begins this way. So our standards are too high. We're too legalistic. And so then first off, they buy TVs. And then they go to movies. And then there was nightclubs. And then there was a little, you know what, wife swapping going on. And then that caused marriages to break. And one particular man that got saved under my ministry, he and his wife split apart. And I tell you this with a broken heart, because what happened was, they broke apart. The man calls his wife, says, "I want you to come home." She says, "No, I'm done." He says, "Come home or I'm going to blow my brains out." And she says, "No, I'm done. I'm not coming home." Well, they have children, so she calls the guy later, and he doesn't answer. So she gets worried about it. She had a key to the trailer. She goes to the trailer. She opens the door, and there's a wall-to-wall brains splattered upon the trailer wall. There's a law in rebellion, and it's called the law of unintended consequences. And I want to say that we have been given such a powerful, powerful legacy, a powerful, powerful advantage in our fellowship, and we need absolutely, like Nehemiah's day. You know what? We build in tumultuous times. We build in dangerous times. So with one hand, we have a hammer or a trowel, and you build, you construct. With the other hand, you have a sword that's ready. So you have to build, and you have to battle, and you have to have a tension between those two facets all through your ministry. Amen. Let me close with this illustration. I read about this masterpiece. I actually have gone to see this. It's called Night Watch in the Rijks Museum in Amsterdam. It's this massive, one-of-a-kind masterpiece by Rembrandt. It's about 11 feet wide and 9 or 10 feet tall. It's a masterpiece. But over the process of time, some psychos. One time it was knifed and cut. Another time, I think it was in 1980 or 1990, somebody brought some battery acid and rushed up and threw the battery acid. And my point is this. It takes a master to create. Any fool can destroy a masterpiece. Thank God the guards were vigilant. And they jumped on the dude, and they got him down, and they pacified him. They were able to rescue the painting. But the whole point is that you can never take anything for granted. As our Lord's brother Jude says, we need to contend for the faith that was once and for all delivered unto us. Let's bow our heads right now. Thank you, Lord.
Praise God. Tremendous ministry. We're going to break this stream right now, end that one, and we'll begin our service stream in just a few moments. The Lord bless you. We'll see you soon.